Good morning, or should I say good afternoon? Welcome to the Faith Community Bible Church virtual worship. I am Pastor Burden. I'm delighted today to be in worship with you guys. As we prepare our hearts and minds for worship today, I'm going to ask if you will stand where you are. Well, I'm at home, Pastor Mike. I'm in front of the couch. I'm at the dining room table. Okay, well, just stand up anyway. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to open us up with scripture. Then I'll pray. Before we do that, I want to welcome all of our visitors here today to the Faith Community Bible Church virtual worship. If you would like more information about Faith Community Bible Church, please check us out at fcbcstl.com. FCBCSTL.com. Make sure you fill out a visitor's card. FCBCSTL.com/respond. Okay. As we prepare our hearts and minds for worship today, let me read our scripture for today that will come from Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. Here it goes. Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing songs and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. That is Colossians 3, verses 12 through 17. And the word of the Lord is blessed. Bow your heads with me and let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for the privilege that you've given us today to worship you virtually. God, I pray that every individual on this virtual worship, every home that's represented on this virtual worship, we be blessed today. I pray, God, that as we worship you, Lord, that we will be attentive in our worship. God, that we won't just use this as a check off the list, God, but that it'll be one where our hearts are in tune with you. God, that we will hear your voice clearly, Lord. But moreover, you be glorified in all we say and do. God, let us sing together. Let us lift our hands together. Let us be energetic in our worship. But Lord, moreover, let us experience you. Father, we love you. Hallelujah. We honor you. We adore you, Jesus. We magnify you, Lord. We make you big, Father, because you and you alone are worthy of all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. Our life belongs to you. And we pray today, Lord, that you receive our worship. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Y'all remain standing, if you will, and receive our worship team at this time as we worship together.
Trust in you, the Lord. I will remain will see the goodness of the
Amen. Super thankful today for our worship team reminding us of the importance of waiting on the Lord. Now, if that's your testimony today, if you will remain confident that you will see the goodness of the Lord, will you just worship Him where you are? Give the Lord praise where you are. I will remain confident in this, that I will see the goodness of the Lord. See, when you know where hope is, you know that you can have confidence in Jesus's finished work on the cross. Remember, because hope is a confident expectation that God is going to do just what He said. And let me tell you this, what a joy it is to hope in Jesus. We set our hope on You, Lord. We set our hope on Your love. We set our hope on the One who is the everlasting God. We have the privilege to hope in Jesus today. No matter what happens in this world, genuinely converted, blood-bought believer, what a privilege it is to hope in the Lord today. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus, for giving hope to us. We love You, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go to Colossians 3, y'all. Colossians 3. Colossians 3 is where we are. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship You, Jesus. Hallelujah. We thank You, God. We thank You, Jesus. Hallelujah. We bless You, God. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Father, we adore You. We magnify You, Jesus. Hallelujah. We make Your name big, God. Hallelujah. We are confident, Lord, that You are going to do just what You said. We are confident, Lord, that as we wait on You, Father, You will be glorified. I pray today, Jesus, that as Your word goes forth, God, that You will be glorified, Lord, that we will hear Your voice. I pray today, God, that You will be the object of our affection. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in Your sight. My strength and my redeemer. Father, it's such an honor and a privilege, God, not only to be in relationship with You, Lord, but what a joy it is. What a joy it is to lead Your people. And I pray today that You will be glorified in it. We love You, Lord, and we thank You for hearing our prayer. Amen. Amen. Colossians 3. Colossians chapter 3. Verses 12 through 17. Just as a reminder, y'all, we are in a series. It's actually coming to an end here in a couple of weeks, but we're in a series through Paul's epistle to the church of Colossae, that Paul's letter to the Colossians, titled Centered. Centered. And this is just a reminder and an encouragement for us that no matter what life presents to us, we must be centered in Jesus. And Colossians has been the driving force for us to really see this. So Colossians chapter 3 is where we are. And I'm going to read verses 12 through 17. Here it is. Colossians chapter 3, beginning at verse 12. Here it is. Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Such is the reading of the word. The word of the Lord is blessed. Again, that's Colossians 3, verses 12 through 17. Amen. And just for a subject today, y'all, I want to preach, if I can, from the subject, the life of the chosen. The life of the chosen. The life of the chosen. Now listen, faith community, family, and friends, there's just been so much going on lately. So much going on. COVID-19, coronavirus, racial tension, political frustrations. On top of all of that, just the regular rhythms of life. There's been so much going on around us. But that being said, I want to ask you a question. How do you view it? How do you view life? When you look at yourself in a mirror in this time, what do you see? Are you comfortable with the reflection? If there was to be a camcorder to follow you around every moment of every day in this current season of your life, would you be comfortable with what you saw on videotape? What needs to change about you? How do you view life? I'm going to tell you, since I've been a kid, y'all, on and off, I've always worn glasses. I've always had to wear glasses. I've always had to, for lack of better terms, have windshields to cover up my eyeballs, right? And some of them was thick. Some of them was thin. Some big, some small, but I've always had to wear glasses. Some of them I use screws to hold the frames together. Some of them I use duct tape. If you don't know nothing about holding glasses together with duct tape, you ain't experienced living. Right? I had to hold it together with duct tape, right? But at the end of the day, it was still glasses. And one thing that would always get me, though, about wearing them was that whatever conditions the lenses were in determined the clarity of my view. Whatever, don't miss this. Whatever condition the lenses were in is what determined the clarity of my view. If the lenses were clean, then everything that I saw was very clean and clear. If the lenses were scratched, then everything that I saw had a scratch. If the lenses were dusty and dirty, then everything that I laid my eyes on was dusty and dirty. The older I've become, the more I've realized that the principle isn't only for those who wear glasses, but also for those who don't. Whatever lenses you view life from will be revealed in everything that you lay your eyes on. Yes, life has a way of scratching, getting dusty and dirty, or even attempts to break us loose. But believer, let me share with you that you must view life from a gospel lens, that whatever is trying to block your view, you must view life from a lens of the gospel. Well, let me define the gospel. The gospel is the only story in history where the hero died for the villain. The gospel is the good news of Jesus' coming to provide forgiveness of sin to all who believe. And those of us who belong to Jesus must view life from that lens. We don't only need the gospel at the moment of salvation, but we need it every single day of our lives. The gospel ought to shape how we view this life and how we view people, meaning that everything in our life, if we have a gospel view, everything in our life must reflect Jesus. And that's what I want each of you to grasp today. That's what I want to put in front of you, that listen, main point. Here it is, main point. When you are chosen by Jesus to be in relationship with Jesus, then everything in your life must reflect Jesus. Let me say it again for the note takers, right? Listen, when you are chosen by Jesus to be in relationship with Jesus, then your life, then everything about it must reflect Jesus. You want to know why? Okay. I'm gonna attempt to help you understand why. Let me tell you why. Because Paul tells us right here in Colossians 3, he said, remember, he opened up this chapter telling us that we have been set free in Christ to seek those things which are above. Right? He says, seek those things which are above. And then he says, not only should we seek what's above, but we must also set our mind on things above. See, this is possible, y'all. How is this possible? Because we've been raised with Christ. See, in the past, we are hidden with Christ in the present, and we will appear with him in glory in the future. Therefore, we are to put to death, y'all, and put off the old life and put to death, put off the old life, put off our old self, and put on the things that characterize our new self. See, he wasn't just talking to random people here in this chapter. He wasn't just talking to random people. He was talking to those who belong to Jesus. See, that's why he said those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved. He was talking to those who were chosen of God, those who were holy, those who know and understand that they are the beloved or in genuine relationship with Jesus. See, this designates true Christians as those who have been chosen by God. See, no one is converted solely by his own choice. Don't miss it, right? Let me tell you this. The life of the chosen. Let me tell you this. You ain't choose God. You ain't choose him, because if the choice is left up to you, you go your own way. Every single time, no one is converted by his own choice, but only in response, watch this, to God's grace. When you are chosen by Jesus to be in relationship with Jesus, your life must reflect Jesus. In view of what God has done through Christ for the believer, Paul describes the behavior and attitude that God expects in response. Believers, see, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, right here in this text, there are four actions in the life of those who belong to Jesus. Four actions. We must put on character, behave in peace, dwell in the word, and represent Christ. I'm going to break these down for you, right? And I'm going to point it out to you, right? Number one, right? Four actions in the life of those who belong to Jesus. Number one, right? When you are chosen, right? Since you are chosen, number one, right? You must put on character. You must behave in peace. You must dwell in the word, and you must represent Christ. Here it is. Number one. First, number one. Text says, right? Then we got to put on character. Watch what he says in verses 12 through 14. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness and patience, bearing with one another. And if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. You also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. We must put on godly character. Let me share something with you today. Your character, listen. Your character is the qualities that make up who you are. And listen, that character is influenced and developed by your choices. Our character is influenced and developed by our choices. See, a person's character is the sum of his or her disposition. A person's character is the sum of their thoughts. A person's character is the sum of their intentions. A person's character is the sum of their desires. A person's character is the sum of their actions. See, it's good to remember that character is gauged by general tendencies, not on the basis of a few isolated actions. It's not just something that you do every now and then. Your character is who you are. It's how you live on a daily basis. It's what you practice. See, that's why he uses this term here, put on. See, some translations say, clothe yourself. See, knowing that right? It brings the passage to life. It connects this passage to the previous one. Because you belong to Jesus, you are beloved. Because you belong to Jesus, you are to wear holiness. Because you belong to Jesus, you are chosen by God. You must change. What am I saying? Change clothes. What am I saying? You have to take off the old, dirty, filthy clothes, right? He said it. Sexual immorality, impurity, anger, wrath, malice, lying, and put on. Clothe yourselves with a new wardrobe. Simply put, what he's saying here is that because you are new, you gotta change. Family, there's no way that we can experience God and not change. Ah! There's no way that you can experience the salvific work of Jesus on the cross and be comfortable allowing sin to control your life. There's no way, no way, no way. There's no way that you can experience Jesus and not change. See, Christians, believers in Jesus, followers of Jesus often fail to change because they try to change solely by breaking bad habits. But listen, change that lasts will not take place until you replace that bad habit with a godly habit. Come here. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22, right through 24. It talks to us about how Christians are to put off or put to death the old sinful earthly way of life, renew their minds with biblical truth, and put on the new godly way of life. See, he didn't just say put on. He told us exactly what our character should look like. He's telling them to put on the fruit of the Spirit, compassionate hearts. Right? We need to display tender feelings of compassion toward one another. And this is not, y'all, something that we turn on and turn off like a TV. No. It's a constant attitude of heart that makes us easy to live with. He say, put on compassionate heart. Then he says, put on kindness. See, we've been saved because of God's kindness toward us through Christ. And we in turn, y'all, ought to show kindness to one another. Ephesians 4:32, be ye kind to one another. That's God's command. We got to be kind to one another. He says, you know, when we're talking about putting on godly character, it's not just being compassionate. It's not only kindness, but it's also humility. See, I know humility is difficult for us to put on because we've bought into the world's idea to do our own thing to the go-go swing. We've bought into this idea, Michaela, that life, it's all about us, what we want, how we want it. We do what we do and how we want to do it, whenever we want to do it, and not pay any regard to anybody else. But no, when you have godly character, you wear humility. See, humility is not thinking poorly of yourself, but rather it is having a proper estimate of oneself in the will of God, knowing that everything you have, everything you are, has nothing to do with you, but everything to do with God. Humility. Humility, right? The person with humbleness of mind thinks of others first and not himself, right? Listen, y'all know, right? Life verse, Philippians 2, talks to us about, right, how Jesus emptied himself by coming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross, right? He says, think of others more, make others more significant than yourself. That's what a godly character, that's what humility looks like. See, Romans 12:3, for by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. You got to be humble. You want to have a godly character, you got to be humble, right? Let me tell you this. Having a godly character also means, watch this, being meek. Being meek. Now, let me help you understand this. Meekness is not weakness. Meekness is not weakness. Well, what is meekness? Meekness is simply power under control. Power under control. See, the meek person don't have to fly off the handle because they have everything under control. A meek person, let me tell you this, understands that the power that they have is loaned to them because all the power belongs to Jesus. Meekness. See, 1 Timothy 1:15-16, the saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I'm the foremost, but I received mercy for this reason, that in me as the foremost, Christ might display his perfect patience as an example to those who are to believe in him for eternal life. Y'all, we must be patient. That's what meekness is being patient. Power under control. See, when a person, right, talks about godly character, having patience, right? When a person is long suffering, he can put up with provoking people or circumstances or even suffering without retaliating. That's what patience is. Godly character has patience. See, it's good to be able to get angry because that's a sign of holy character. But it's wrong to get angry quickly at the wrong things and for the wrong reasons. We must be patient. We must bear with one another. Listen. Let me remind you of something today. Everyone has an experience. But everybody hasn't experienced what you've experienced. Everybody don't think like you. Everyone doesn't learn things like you do. Therefore, you must be patient and bear with one another. Godly character. You got to wear some forgiveness. Let me tell you. When we think about this whole thing about forgiveness, see, we often think about it one-sided. Forgiving somebody else or somebody forgiving us. But let me just ask you a question. When was the last time you forgave yourself? How can you continue to live for Jesus, be chosen by God, but you have not forgiven yourself? Here's the reality. If you didn't do what you did, you still wouldn't be worthy anyway. That's what makes salvation such a great gift. You gotta forgive yourself. Having godly character, yes, is forgiving others, but it's also you forgiving you. Christ died so that you can be forgiven, not just for your sins, but you have to forgive yourself. Forgiveness, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. He says, if anyone has a complaint against another, see, the point here is that of keeping oneself in check, even when you're irritated by others. And the forgetting of offenses personally received. See, we have to do so looking to Christ as our example. See, even as Christ forgave you, so you must do. You must also forgive one another. Believers can and must be forgiving people. That's why Matthew 6, 14 and 15 says, "For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses." Well, Pastor, I forgive people, but I just have a hard time forgiving me. Let me tell you this. One of the reasons why we have a hard time forgiving ourselves is because we think we have more power than we actually have. You don't have no power. Do you know that everything you touch, you contaminate? Therefore, you must forgive yourself. Godly character. He's talking a lot here about character. He talked about forgiveness. He's talking about patience. He's talking about humility, kindness, compassionate hearts. But then he begins to talk about love. See, when love rules in our lives, y'all, it unites all these spiritual virtues so that there is beauty and harmony indicating, watch this, spiritual maturity. Do you know that if you haven't learned how to operate in love, then none of the other character traits make sense? Because every other character trait that we are called to live in, every other character trait that the Lord has placed before us is all fueled by his love. See this harmony, this maturity is actually what keeps our life balanced and keeps our life growing. See, we have to learn to look at love like a belt. See, it holds everything else in place, and without it, everything else falls and we become exposed. Oh, Jesus. Think about love like a belt. Love is what holds us together. Love is what causes us to be in relationship with one another. Love is what causes us, right, to be patient. Love is what causes us to be kind. Love is what causes us to be meek. Love is what causes us to be patient. Y'all remember the song, "When Nothing Else Can Help, Love Lifted Me." When nothing else could help, love is the belt that holds us together. And the moment we remove our belt is the moment that everything falls, right? And we become exposed. We gotta love one another. The greatest way, y'all, for us to reflect Christ. Listen, the greatest way for us to reflect Christ is to love one another, right? I want you to know that scripture has a lot to say about love. And Jesus tells us 11 times, somewhere around 11 times in the scriptures, to love one another. John 13:34, a new command I give to you, that you love one another. Come here. Romans 12:10, love one another with brotherly affection. I holler at Romans 13:8, owe no one anything except love each other. Love is the adhesive of the church. And the moment that the church, not the building, but the people, stops loving one another is when the church falls apart. The moment we allow love to be removed from us is the moment that we really prove that we ain't chosen. All right. Oh, you need scripture. Okay. You need scripture. Let me give you scripture. How will people know that we belong to Jesus? By our love. So if our godly character isn't wrapped in love, then check your spiritual pulse, because you just might be spiritually dead. We have to have godly character. When you are chosen by Jesus to be in relationship with Jesus, your life must reflect Jesus. You must put on godly character. Not only should we put on godly character, but number two, here it is. We must behave in peace. We must behave in peace. Watch what he says in verse 15. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body. See, listen, church. Listen. Faith community, family and friends, listen. When you clothe yourself with Christian character, it produces peace. When your life reflects Christ, peace rules you. Let me tell you this, right? Peace is not a thing, but rather, peace is a person. Peace is not a thing. Peace is a person. And when our life, right, reflects Christ, peace rules us. See, this word rule, Tyler, simply means to umpire. Right? The peace of God should govern our hearts. When you think about the role and responsibility of an umpire in a baseball game, the role of the umpire is to govern the game. The umps govern the game to make sure that all the rules are being played. Let me tell you this. The peace of God ought to be our ump. The peace of God governs our hearts. See, there are a lot of folks who profess Christ in several ways, but when they look at their life, it's chaotic. Folks profess Christ in all these different ways, right? But when you look at their life, you find so much chaos. Life seems to be in shambles. But let me share with you, church, that where there's no peace, there's chaos. And those of us who belong to Jesus, we cannot allow our passions or our desires to govern us, but we must let peace govern us. Where there's no peace, there's chaos. Now, watch this. Come on in. Let me help you, right? Let me tell you this. There can still be peace in the midst of chaos. But when you have chaos and no peace, that means that you've boxed God out. Let me tell you this, right? The peace of God surpasses all understanding. See, the things that we don't understand brings chaos, but God brings peace in the midst of it, right? Listen, let me remind you of this, that peace is not a thing, but rather peace is a person. Yes, peace is a person, and we must be governed by peace. peace. Well, if peace is not a thing, Pastor, if peace is a person, then why are we saying no justice, no peace? That's because we think peace is a thing. But how do we see reconciliation? How do we see unity? How can we see people groups come together? Socioeconomic, how can we see all these things come together? Because peace is a person and not a thing. Because we want peace our way and not God's way. Peace is not a thing. Peace is a person. Peace is Jesus. All right, come here. Ephesians 2, 11 through 16. Therefore, remember that at one time, you Gentiles in the flesh called the uncircumcision, by which is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers of the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. He said, don't forget that you too at one point was jacked up. Don't forget that you too was one of those people who would have killed him if you had the chance. But then verse 13 begins to switch gears a little bit. He says, but, oh man, I wonder, is there anybody who learned how to shout off the butt a little bit? I ain't got no rhythm, but I'm feeling it. I wish I could shout a little bit. He says, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were once were far off have been brought near by the blood of the cross. For he himself, here's the shout, for he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in a place of two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, therefore killing hostility. What is that saying? If we want to see hostility killed, peace is how it's done. Peace is how it's done. When you are chosen by Jesus to be in relationship with Jesus, your life must reflect Jesus. Everything about you must reflect Jesus. We must behave in peace. Number three, here it is. Number three, we got to dwell in the word. Now, I know dwelling in the word, y'all, challenges a lot of believers. It challenges us a little bit, because knowing that we should dwell in the word really reveals to us the motives and intentions of our heart. It reveals to us our lack of discipline to the word. It reminds us of our lack of commitment to the word. And I want to be specific when I say lack of discipline in the word, or lack of commitment in the word. And the reason why I'm being specific there is because it's not that we aren't disciplined people. We're not disciplined people. I was reading a couple months ago this survey done by the Barna Group, and it talked about the high percentage of people who log on Facebook daily. And on top of that, a high percentage of them was the church. We ain't got no discipline problem because we log on Facebook a million times a day. Right? Then they did another survey, Miss Tracy, about commitment. And understanding that, right, a high percentage of people were committed to other things outside of God, but a high percentage was believers. So we don't have a discipline problem. We don't have a commitment problem. We have a discipline to the word problem. We have a commitment to the word problem. What am I saying? When your life belongs to Jesus, when you are the chosen, you must dwell in the word. You got to dwell in the word. He says in verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing songs and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Let me tell you this. I ain't saying everybody don't dwell in the word. I'm just saying a large percentage don't. A large percentage don't. Listen, let me tell you this. It does little good if Christians declare and defend the truth but fail to demonstrate it in their life. It does us no good to declare the word and defend our faith when our life don't show it. There are some Christians, y'all, who defend the truth at the drop of a hat, but their personal lives deny the doctrines that they profess to love. That's why we've allowed musicians to come sleep through our churches. That's why we've allowed pastors to creep in churches. That's why church discipline ain't acting. We won't practice Matthew 18 because it really reveals the position of our hearts. Right? We okay with folks sleeping around in the church. Well, let me tell you why. Because we place offering over conversion. We care more about how much people can drop in the offering basket than we do about their hearts being converted. But let me tell you this. The moment that we think that the amount of money we give determines our position in Christ is the moment where we lose it. Right? If you ain't, let me tell you this. If you not being converted, keep your money. Because you can't buy your way to heaven. You cannot buy your way to heaven, right? You must be converted. You got to experience Jesus. And that won't happen if you don't allow the word to dwell richly in you. See, we defend the truth at the drop of a hat. But their personal lives deny the doctrines that they profess to love. See, we love it when we're in front of people. But when we think the cameras are off and nobody's looking, we want to do our own thing, y'all. There are many people who are great on doctrine and want to be fundamental in the faith. And that's important. These people can often be heard praising in Bible study. Yet they don't, you know, they praise Bible study. They praise being in the word. They praise being around other folks. But they don't attend Bible study. And they know so little about the word of God that anytime they begin to feel empty, they blame everybody else, but don't take responsibility for themselves. See, these are the same people that only come around when they want something. Only come around when their life is beat up, but when all things good, they push believers away. No. I remember, y'all, when I was a kid, it seemed like when people had a rough day, they would say things like, I just need a nice warm bath to relax. That would be their way of decompressing. Only if I just had a glass of wine. Let me tell you this. The best compression, the best relaxation regimen that we can ever add to the rhythm of our life is to soak in the scriptures. The greatest way that we can ever relax, the greatest way that we can ever decompress, right, is to soak in the word. John 15:3, you are clean because of the word that I spoke to you. Let me tell you, the best Saturday night bath that you can take is to study the word. The best right time you can ever spend on PlayStation 4, right, is to turn the game off and turn your Bible on, right? Dwell in the word. See, dwell means to be at home, to be given the run of the house. Listen, dwell, to be at home, to be given the run of the house, right? We should be familiar with the word of God. See, the Bible should not be a strange book to us. Right, there's no way that we can say we got relationship with Jesus, but the Bible is a strange book to us. The Bible should not be a strange book to you. Scripture should permeate every aspect of a believer's life and control every thought, every word, every deed of our life. See, Psalms 119, how can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart, I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Why we being controlled by sin is because the word ain't taking up residence in our heart. When you are chosen by Jesus to be in relationship with Jesus, then your life must reflect Jesus. We got to dwell in the word. Listen, believer, every area of our life, grab this today. Take hold of this. If you have responded to the gospel in faith, then you belong to him. Therefore, your life, everything about you must reflect Jesus. Not only in how we live, but also in how we deal with people. God has chosen us believers to be in relationship with him. Think about this. Think about this. Oh, Jesus. Think. He could have chose anybody, but he chose you. In spite of your feelings, in spite of your circumstances, in spite of COVID-19, in spite of racial tensions, in spite of the amount of money that you do or don't have in your bank account, he still chose you. He chose you. God has chosen us to be in relationship with him. And in view of what God has done through Christ for the believer, Paul describes the behavior and attitude that God expects from us in response. Believer, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, there are four actions in this life of those who belong to Jesus. First, we must put on godly character. Second, we got to behave in peace. Third, we got to dwell in the Word. Allow the Word to take up residence in us. And finally, we must represent Christ. Verse 17 says this: "And whatever you do in word or in deed," he says, "do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." See, this simply means, right? We talk about representing Christ. This simply means to act consistently with who he is and what he wants. We must act consistently with who he is and what he wants. Everything that we do ought to point to Jesus. The life of a genuinely converted, blood-bought believer ought to be an arrow that points directly to Jesus. As Christians, y'all, we must bear the name of Christ. The name of Christ then means for us identification. It means that we belong to Christ. But his name also means authority. A man's name signed to a check authorizes the withdrawal of money from the bank. The president's name signed to a bill makes it a law. In that same way, it is the name of Jesus Christ that we have the authority to pray. Because Christ is God and he has died for us, we have authority in his name. All that we say, all that we do should be associated with the name of Jesus. By our words and our works, we should glorify his name. See, if we permit anything into our lives that cannot be associated with the name of Jesus, then there's a strong chance that we are sinning. We must do and say everything on the authority of his name and for the honor of his name. See, bearing the name of Jesus is a privilege. Bearing the name of Jesus is a tremendous privilege, but it's also a tremendous responsibility. Why is it a tremendous responsibility? Because we suffer persecution because we bear his name. Let me tell you this. I would much rather suffer persecution for bearing his name than suffer persecution for bearing my own. See, since we have united with Christ through the indwelling Holy Spirit, y'all, we have all the resources we need for holy living. But we have to be, but here's the deal. But we have to be spiritually motivated to do it. See, many of us, right, only want to live holy because we're looking for a pat on the back. But when you are spiritually motivated, you're not looking for a pat on the back. You're looking for God to be glorified. See, because we've experienced the grace of Christ, we want to live for him. Because we have enjoyed the peace of Christ, we must want to obey him. We've been enriched by the word of Christ and ennobled by the name of Christ. Therefore, we must want to honor and glorify him. When you are chosen, right, you must represent Christ. When you are chosen by Jesus to be in relationship with Jesus, your life and everything about you must reflect Jesus. Listen, how do you view life? When you look at yourself in the mirror, what do you see? Are you comfortable with the reflection? If there was to be a reality show about you called This Is Your Life, and you were to sit back and look at the camera angles of you, how would you feel about what you see? What about you needs to change? How do you view life? Let me tell you this. In Christ, there's no barriers. We are one in him, and he is all in all. If Christ is the center of our lives, then we must reflect him in our lives. He must get the glory out of our lives. If there are differences, the peace of God will umpire. The peace of God will rule our hearts as we feed on the word and worship Christ. Believer, listen. How you view life shouldn't be contingent upon the current conditions of it. Let me tell you again. How you view life should not be contingent upon the current conditions of your life. But how we view life should be fueled by how we view Jesus. And if we view Jesus as the beginning and the end, if we view Jesus as the first and the last, if we view Jesus as all things in between, if we view Jesus as Alpha and Omega, if we view Jesus, right, as the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, if we view Jesus as the one who holds all things together, if we view Jesus as omnipotent, if we view Jesus as all-knowing, if we view Jesus as sovereign, if we view Jesus as way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light over darkness, if we view Jesus as the man in control, then you will understand how you ought to view this life. Let me tell you this. One of the greatest movies I ever seen was Training Day, right? Denzel pulled old boy alongside of him, tried to teach him everything he knew. So much so that at the end, Denzel, I was about to die with his chest out, he said, King Kong ain't got nothing on me. Denzel had this confidence that because of who he thought he was and the clout that he thought he had, he was able to have confidence to say King Kong ain't had nothing on him. But I wonder, Miss Tracy, if we really began to see Jesus as sovereign, can we still hold that same confidence that today we can shout COVID ain't got nothing on me? If we can stand firm in the confidence of Jesus to say racial tension ain't got nothing on me. If we can stand firm and say the political frustrations ain't got nothing on me, not because of who we are, but because of the confidence that we have in Jesus. David said earlier, I will remain confident in this, that I will see the goodness of the Lord. Believer, how you view life shouldn't be contingent upon the current conditions of it, but how we view life should be fueled by how we view Jesus, because our lives ought to reflect him. When you are chosen by God, when you are chosen by Jesus to be in relationship with Jesus, then your life must reflect Jesus. Does your life point to you, or does it point to Jesus? We are chosen by him to be in relationship with him. Therefore, everything in our life must reflect him. Let's pray. Father, we've tried our own way. Father, we've tried to make things the way we wanted to make them. Truth is, Jesus, is that we failed it. We failed at it. We failed, Lord, simply because many times all we want is what we want, how we want it, and when we want it. But we have joy in you, Jesus, to know, God, that our life is not our own, but that we belong to you. So, God, I pray for my brothers and sisters, my family and friends that are watching this virtually today. I pray today, God, that you will begin to x-ray their hearts, x-ray their minds, God. That they will, Lord, be able to pinpoint what it is in their life that's not reflecting you. But I pray that you give them the courage, give them the discipline needed to do your will. I pray today, God, that you will empower us with your spirit, not only to be forgiven to one another, Lord, but to forgive ourselves. Reality, Lord, is that none of us are perfect. None of us have it all together. But God, we need your glory. We need your spirit. So God, I pray that you will rest on us, that we will be more like you. I'm asking you today, Father, that if there's anyone on this virtual stream that don't know you, I pray that you will capture their heart. I pray that they will come to know you, Lord. That God, you will help them to know that even, oh Lord, as they have experienced hurt and pain from others, but that God, you are able to mend their hearts. I pray today that we will not only know you more, but that we will trust you more, and that you will be glorified with our life. Thank you for choosing us to be in relationship with you. Thank you for taking care of us. Thank you for being our provider. And I pray today, Lord, that we will make much of you and that you will be glorified. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you all for logging in today to Faith Community Bible Church's virtual worship. My prayer today is that you guys were challenged, encouraged, and convicted by the word that was shared today. If you would like to respond to the word today through prayer, or if you've given your life to Christ, go to our virtual response card at fcbcstl.com/respond and let us know how we can pray for you or serve you in the future. Okay? Let us know how we can pray for you. If you would like to give to support the work and ministry of Faith Community, go to fcbcstl.com/give. And it will be such a joy for you to support the work that we're doing. Y'all, let me just be honest. I miss gathering with y'all. I miss being in y'all's face. I miss the hugs, right? I miss the dinner fellowships. I miss hanging out with y'all. But in due time, God will allow that to happen for us. But in this time, y'all just be patient. Let's keep praying for one another. Y'all, if folks you haven't talked to, pick up the phone and call them. See how you can be praying for them. Maybe you can set up a virtual lunch meeting, virtual family dinner, whatever you can do, right? But get in relationship with one another. Because I'm going to tell you this, the mission has not changed. It just looks different. So we thank you so much for your support and prayers for Faith Community Bible Church as we exist to make Christ known in the community by caring for the community. I love you guys. God bless you, and God keep you is our prayer. Have a great rest of the day.